Thank you all for coming in this afternoon. We will take you now to a different level. This morning we've heard from politicians and former politicians, but this afternoon we have a very special session. We are lucky to have with us this afternoon four of the most eminent speakers that I know of in the field of Islamic science, engineering, technology. In fact, this session, which we've called ISTI5, is the fifth in a series that was started by two men with a dream. They are sitting here. This is Dato Lee Chung from Malaysia and Dr. Tayyib Mustafa, formerly of UNESCO and currently in Sudan. My two eminent friends had a dream 5 years ago that we should unravel or uncover a lot of the wonderful mysteries of Islamic science and its contribution to world civilization. They did not realize when they started this that I had the same secret passion. Since 2006, we've been trying to get together every now and then and organize a specialized seminar on the history of Islamic science, engineering, and technology, addressing the various aspects of the subject. Without further ado, and in order to save time, I'll hand over to our chair, academician Dato Lee Chung, who's the godfather of this exercise, who will be assisted in running the show for the next 3 or 4 hours by our eminent friend, Dr. Tayyib Mustafa from Sudan. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Monif. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm honored to be called the godfather of this series of annual events, what we call Islamic Science, Technology and Innovation, ISTI. So this is the fifth ISTI since 2006. I would not waste any more of your time. I think you are here not to listen to me, but to eminent speakers. Since Mustafa and myself, we co-chair this session, so we have split the work that I will chair the first session. Then after tea break, he will continue with the next session with two eminent speakers. And after that, if we have time, then we would have a few words about what we plan to do from here onwards. So without further ado, I would like to call the first speaker, which is Professor Emeritus Dr. Rashed. Now, his very detailed CV is on page 36 of the conference publication. So, and I would not read them. And just to mention that he is the Emeritus Research Director, distinguished class at the National Center for Scientific Research, CNRS, France. And he's going to speak to us on Muslim contributions and the turning points in the history of classical mathematics. Professor Rashed.
Thank you. I don't need that. I don't use PowerPoint. There is no picture, nothing, just speaking. Thank you so much, and thank you for your invitation. Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon for everybody. Yes, please take that off. The organizer of the conference decided to include history of science for reasons which had been explained now. I appreciate that very much. Let me thank them for the initiative for this decision, and I shall try to do my best. I would like only to call your attention that when I use mathematics in Islam, or even Islamic mathematics, I mean only mathematics produced by people of different religions and philosophical systems and from different origins between the 8th and 16th century in the Islamic area. That is all. My purpose in this talk is to place Islamic contribution in general history of mathematics. I shall then focus on the turning points and the tradition that carried out research in mathematics. In other words, I shall try in the most objective way to put the facts right and show how mathematics in Islam was an important part of classical mathematics and to show that it is impossible to understand the history of early mathematics, I mean the mathematics in 16th and 17th century Europe, without reference to and without knowing the history of mathematics in Islam. Early modern mathematics, 16th, 17th century in Europe, is neither homogeneous nor all of one piece. Some chapters in its development go back as far as Greek mathematics. We have only to think, for example, of plane geometry, of geometry of conics, or geometry of the spheres. Others are rooted in Islamic mathematics, embracing the algebraic disciplines and work on geometrical transformations. Finally, yet other developments, such as infinitesimal calculus, took place in Europe in the 17th century. What we can say, however, is that the distinctive characteristic of this classical mathematics, or even of classical modernity itself, is that it is algebraic and analytical. The question that remains is precisely when and how this distinctive characteristic, I mean algebraic and analytical, saw the light of day, that is, how this algebraic analytical reasoning arose and how it developed. The foundations of this new type of rationality came from a number of separate initiatives without which it could neither have emerged nor become established. This talk will restrict itself to the initiatives attributable to Islamic mathematicians that were what I shall call founding acts or turning point that means that the points that in the history, in global history of mathematics, these acts were turning point. Other such advances followed in Italian mathematics, the introduction of imaginary quantities. Others came with Vieta and Descartes, the invention of a fully worked out system of symbolic representation, and the same period, which I call the age of the liberation of the infinite, brought yet more, but that is at the end of the 17th century and the beginning of the 18th century. Recent historical studies have now placed beyond the doubt that over at least five centuries, It was above all in the lands of Islam and in the Arabic language that intensive and fruitful mathematical research took place. Between the 8th and the 14th century at least, research in mathematics had been conducted by figures such as, you know all of them, such as Khwarizmi, Thabit ibn Qurra, Ibn al-Haytham, Khayyam, and others, but also by dynasties of scholars who engaged in genuine teamwork within established school. There were the Banu Musa, the Banu Karnib dynasties, for example, the schools of Nizamiya in Baghdad and in Samarkand, and so on. It was certainly cumulative. I mean, this high-level research was, as one might expect, cumulative, diversified, and sometimes revolutionary. It was certainly cumulative in that it was constantly enriching the inheritance left by the ancient mathematician, essentially Greek and Hellenistic, with further progress in all the fields in which they had worked. But it was also cumulative in the sense that it had not taken long for it to become organized into traditions in which each succeeding generation had constantly added its own discoveries to the knowledge acquired by the predecessors. The diversification of this research brought about advances in many areas unknown to the ancient, whose development completely redefined both the organization and the extent of the fields covered by mathematical sciences. This is observable in algebra, algebraic geometry, combinatorial analysis, integer Diophantine analysis, theory of number, trigonometry, among other branches. Finally, it was sometimes revolutionary in breaking ancient taboos and in devising new procedures, treating irrational quantities arithmetically, changing the criteria for admissible geometrical constructions, treating geometrically algebraic algorithms, as well as those of quadratic interpolation, and so on, explicitly introducing movement in geometry, etc. A full picture of this scientific activity, or at the very least, an account of some of the chapters in its development, involves writing its history in sufficient detail to show when it began, what conditions made its beginning possible, how it was organized, what obstacles sprang up in its path, and when it came to an end. My aim is not to rewrite, it is impossible, the history of this research movement, or to tell it, but to attempt what I might call a phenomenological description of it, designed to capture what these beginnings really meant and how far their influence extended. This exercise will help to make clear just where this mathematical research stands in relation to mathematics of the ancient world and that of the modern era. That is, how it relates to Archimedes, Apollonius, Menelaus, Brahmagupta, etc., and on the other hand, to Descartes, Fermat, Cavalieri, Leibniz, on the other hand. A fact that does not receive emphasis is it should is that mathematical research in Islam began in a manner that can perhaps most appropriately be described paradoxical. The very process of translating Euclid's and Greek works provided the opportunity to make the first complete break with the Hellenistic tradition. Put another way, deviation from the Hellenistic mathematics went hand in hand with the learning of it. It was a colleague of the translator in Bayt al-Hikmah, al-Hajjaj, a colleague of him, Khawarizmi, the translator, the Hajjaj translated Euclid Elements, a colleague of him, Khawarizmi, who putting the translation of the elements to good use was responsible for this first break. This event took place in the course of the first third of the 9th century, when Khawarizmi developed a new discipline, algebra. It was a founding act, the constitution of algebra, it was a founding act in several respects, new in its assumption, in the aims it put forward, in the language it forged, and new in the mathematical possibilities opened up. It is worth reminding ourselves that in the first book of algebra, that is the first book universally, in this first book, on the first book of algebra of Khawarizmi, had a precise end in view that was clearly formulated as such, to develop a theory of equations solvable by radicals, to which arithmetical and geometrical problems alike could be reduced and which could thus be applied to calculation, every kind of calculation or practical calculation. The mathematicians who preceded Khawarizmi, as well as the contemporaries in the field, no matter what their languages, formulated their equation in response to the problems they set themselves, whereas Khawarizmi, by constant, started from the equations, that is, from the theory which enabled him to derive and classify these equations. And there was no limit to the number of problems, whether arithmetical or geometrical, that could be produced. Then there is this classification, which is, he has to define the primitive terms. From the primitive terms with a combinatorial procedure, he formulated all the equations, and then the equation that could be solved in an algorithmic way, and once this equations was formulated, he elaborated which kind of algorithm to solve them. That is all that is done in a theoretical way, not in the calculus way, and then tried to prove by another language, by the geometry, the algorithm, and that is the first time that somebody tries to prove the algorithm itself. But this conceptual break with traditions, Babylonian, Greek, Indian, or whatever, has roots that run still deeper, that drew open a new mathematical ontology and also a new epistemology. And that is very important to understand what will happen later on. The central concept of algebra, the unknown, does not in fact designate, as according to traditional ontology it had to, a particular existent, but an object that may equally well be numerical or geometrical. In other words, the subject matter of the new discipline consists neither in geometrical figures nor in rational numbers, and the properties that this discipline is deemed to study are not those of measure anymore than they are of those of position and shape. It is a sharp, it is, its object is something new and is not defined negatively. The mathematical entity finds itself invested with a new meaning, for it is now an entity and in general enough, or it is an entity general enough to admit of several determinations, both geometrical and arithmetical. In other words, the algebraic object conceived by Khwarizmi cannot be obtained by abstraction from particulars, no more can it be derived at by approximate imitation of a form or idea. There is nothing either Aristotelian or Platonic about the new ontology. It is, as it were, formal, and that is the first formal ontology known in the history, and as such, no doubt, the first to be met with the history of mathematics. Its impact on mathematics and thereafter on philosophy was be considerable, as can be seen with the predecessor, the successor of Khwarizmi. Finally, the new discipline, this algebra, is at the same time demonstrative discipline and algorithmic. True enough, the algorithm used in the solution of a problem must itself submit to geometrical proof if, in fact, the solution is thought of as no more than a procedure for decision making, it follows that this procedure must be justified geometrically, that means in a different mathematical language. It was in this respect that Khwarizmi broke with all earlier tradition and the contemporary practice in algorithmic mathematics. That is the first turning point not only in Arabic in Islamic mathematics, but the first turning point in traditional mathematics before the 17th century. Other break with tradition, or if preferred, other fresh starts, prompted by the new way looking at mathematical science, are already included in the new possibilities opened by the groundbreaking ideas and the founding acts. With Khwarizmi algebra, it in fact became possible for the first time to apply the discipline to each other, which was not possible before. I mean, to apply arithmetic to algebra, algebra to arithmetic, algebra to geometry, algebra to trigonometry, and so on. And every one of these applications led to the establishment of a new branches of mathematics, new chapters of mathematics, and as a result, on redrawing the map of the mathematical continent. That is what I call the first founding act and the first turning point. From this moment on, I mean with this conception of algebraic object, we have another ontology which cut with the ancient ontology, I mean with the Platonic ontology and with the Aristotelian ontology, and that will survive al-Khwarizmi and will be common to all mathematics afterwards. Another thing, scarcely three decades after Khwarizmi, the Baghdad mathematician launched themselves open new consequences. This time, armed with a better and ampler knowledge of the heritage left by the Greeks, the research on which they had embarked had in effect given rise to a whole industry dedicated to translating great numbers of Greek books into Arabic, and also to some Sanskrit books into Arabic. I mean, for instance, Apollonius Conics, Archimedes' Measurement of the Circle on the Sphere in the Cylinder, the Eighth Book of Pappus, Le Synagogue, the Spherics of Theudos and the Menelaus, the Arithmetica of Diophantus, and so on and so on and so on. From the 9th century onward, three mutually linked research traditions are to be identified: infinitesimal geometry, conical geometry, and spherical geometry. There still remains the problem of identifying which particular initiatives were the new founding acts that distinguished each of these traditions and led the inheritors of Hellenistic mathematics to develop the area study concerned. The advances in question, it seems to me, can be summed up under the following two headings. First of all, pointwise transformation. Next, continuous movement. Let us examine them in order. In the course of certain of their proofs, Archimedes and also Apollonius make use of pointwise transformations. Apollonius, particularly in his book, which is called Plane Loci, probably makes use of transformation. This said, Archimedes' book was never translated into Arabic, and all we know about Apollonius is what Pappus tells us. Neither Apollonius' book nor Pappus' statement reached in Baghdad. That what I try to say is only the following, that about the usage of pointwise transformation or punctual transformation that was not really inherited from Greek mathematics. But that is just a historical fact. This fact finds confirmation in the way that the concept of pointwise transformation was treated in the Islamic mathematics. Let me summarize it very quickly. We can say the following. The Greek geometry, it is a geometry of figures. We are working on a figure and the relations in the figure. From the 9th century on, there will be a big change. From now, we are interested in relations between figures and in relations inside the figures itself. That means we are more interested in pointwise transformation or punctual transformation. And that changes a lot in the conception of the geometrical object. This change of the geometrical object and of the type of the study, I mean, we are now studying the relations between figures and not only relation inside figures, was the second founding act of Islamic mathematics, the introduction of pointwise transformation, not just as part of proofs, but as a geometrical concept in their own right. This advance, unlike the one that marked the foundation of algebra, was not the result of action of a single individual, but the outcome of several scholars working in different fields at the same time. These fields being infinitesimal geometry and the science of projection, as the ancient mathematician and the bibliographers called it. This founding act goes back in particular to the three mathematicians of Baghdad, the Banu Musa, and especially to the youngest of these three brothers, Al-Hasan, along with their pupil, Thabit ibn Qurra, and the astronomer mathematician Al-Farghani. The discovery was repeatedly demonstrated, confirmed, and developed in a greater depth in the following century. It can be seen from the work of many people like Biruni, Ibn al-Haytham in the 11th century. The key to our understanding of how it arose lies in the interest in the geometry of cones first generated by the translation of Apollonius conics. There is no time here to follow the development that took place in this field from the time of Farghani up to the time of Biruni. To appreciate how much ground had been covered since Farghani, it will be enough to mention only some of the topics studied by mathematicians like Kuhi Ibn Sa'd in the course of the second half of the 10th century. These two examined conic projections from a point on the axis or outside the axis of a sphere, cylindrical projection in a direction parallel or not parallel to the axis of the sphere, and obtained a good many new and important results that used to be attributed to later mathematicians from the 16th and 17th century. And this was not all. In this field, mathematicians like Kuhi, among others, sought out new procedures for proofs and forged a new language. Another application of pointwise transformation that we see developing in the drawing of conic curves, and that the problem how to draw the conic curves. The problem presented by them probably goes back to the time when geometry was first brought into the study of sundials and the burning mirrors. On the other hand, we can be quite certain that a number of factors contributed to the renewal of interest in the drawing of conic curves. There was the revival of astronomical research for one thing, and the resumption of research on burning mirrors. And in fact, they developed many methods to draw the curves either by points, but most important, to a continuous drawing of curves, and they invented instruments like a universal compass to draw at the same time the straight line, the circle, and the conics. And this invention was transmitted later on in Italy, a famous mathematician Italian, Parozzi, who reproduced exactly the same compass that was invented some centuries before by Kuhn. But during the course of the 10th century particularly, owing to the requirements to be met in the construction of geometrical problems, on the one hand, and the solution of cubic equations by the intersection of conic curves, on the other hand, it was no longer enough to draw these curves by means of point, and from this moment, they developed the method and the instrument to trace continuously the curves. Then, pointwise transformation or continuous movement associated with punctual transformation alike characterized the founding act of the new and revival of other fields of study in geometry from the middle of the 9th century onwards. This is what we have seen with the science of projection. The drawing of conic curves advanced in three other areas also illustrate the point geometrical construction, the theory of parallels, and lastly, infinitesimal geometry. All that push to try to understand what exactly, how can we use the movement in geometry. As you know, all of you, at least, that in Greek geometry, at least in Euclid's element, that is, in the book, the fundamental book of Greek geometry, the only axiomatic book of Greek geometry, movement was, rejected. There is no use of movement. And even if there was a use of movement, it is indirect use and not admitted use, secret use of movement, but not clear use of movement. But all with this founding acts, point-wise transformation, continuous drawing of curves, and the many other projections, the problems of the projection, all that imposed to think anew the place of movement in the in geometry. And for this reason, a mathematician like Ibn al-Haytham composed a huge book to rethink all geometry with the concept of movement. And that this book, which is called The Known, is a very important book from this time and in the history of mathematics at all. I will not take all the time. I want to jump to the conclusion, because there are other many things, to jump to the conclusion. Then, let me read it. In order to understand how geometry developed in this period, it is essential to appreciate the part played by these two elements in the advances that led to the established, I take once more. From one side, let me conclude. Pointwise transformations and the continuous movement were, from the middle of the 9th century and throughout the 10th, among the main founding elements of different chapters of geometry. And in order to understand how geometry developed in this period, it is essential to appreciate the part played by these two elements in the advances that led to the establishment of the separate subject areas. The presence of these notions, which more and more often intervened in their work, could not help raising new questions for the mathematicians. And the comfort and, for instance, how could the role of either one of them be made legitimate? How could we legitimate the introduction of movement, how to rebuild the geometry with the concept of movement? It is legitimate or not? How could the notion of movement be admitted in the terms of propositions and proofs when it had never been defined? These two questions, which are clearly connected, raised another just as important. If from now on the business of mathematician was to be the relationships between figures, their transformation and their movement, was it not time to rethink the notion of space? The question of space could no longer be allowed to remain in the shadows, and it was quite equally impossible to continue to preserve the Aristotelian topos, space, or loci, the place envelope. These questions began to emerge at the end of the 10th century as certain of mathematicians from Iran, like Sizi, writing attest, before becoming, with Ibn al-Haytham, food of reflection and innovation. Let us briefly turn our attention just to the question of continuous movement. The attitude, So that is with Ibn al-Haytham wrote a treatise on space or on loci, and that was the first mathematization of the concept of space. Until now we consider that it was the action of 17th century mathematician who mathematized space, but Ibn al-Haytham in this book gave the first mathematician of of the concept of space and refused the traditional concept of place or space or of place envelope. The attitude, I mean, then we conclude, the attitude of Platonist geometers, dedicated as it was by the theory of ideas, resulted in their outlawing de jure, en principe, any consideration of movement in the elements of geometry. The attitude of Aristotelian geometers was the same because of their doctrine of abstraction. The truth, however, may be that their stance was due less to their commitment to a particular ontology than to the fact that the kind of geometry that essentially concerned with the study of figures had no great need for the notion of movement. Even when the need for movement made itself felt, it is not unusual to find it being avoided in de jure, only to be brought in.
Professor, inside. Can you finish in 3 minutes?
I conclude. I am concluding now, no problem. Supposition, in fact, necessary involves displacement in any case. Then we have that. Something again, it is something else again to include movement among the primitive terms of geometry. That would be to take a positive attitude in regard to movement and its role in definitions and the proof. But such an approach requires a reconfiguration of the concept of geometry, or at the very least, a certain number of them. They need to be rethought in terms of movement, and the notion of geometrical locus must be looked at afresh. Now, for an adaptation of this kind, there obviously needed to be new basis, a new and distinct discipline, and a different methodology. Ibn al-Haytham was the first, to my knowledge, to have attempted this reorganization by conceiving a new discipline that we call this discipline the nones, by working out a kind of ars analytica and reformulating the notion of geometrical locus. After him, further attempt of this kind would have to wait until the second half of the 17th century, and particularly for Leibniz's analysis sutus. There are another founding acts in other geometrical disciplines, the combination of spherical geometry and the trigonometry, to do away with Menelaus' theorem, for example. Later on, there would be many others, Descartes' invention of symbolism, the introduction of imaginary quantities, exact representation. The same is true of other branches of mathematics, decimal arithmetic, the classification of mathematical propositions, the technique of analysis and synthesis, and more generally, the philosophy of mathematics. In a word, in all these fields, the principal founding acts of classical mathematics are to be rediscovered. It not be until the Italian algebraic school in the 16th century, Descartes geometry, Fermat Diophantine analysis, and also the infinitesimal geometry of the 18th century, that other founding acts would take place, which along with those who have just picked out shaped the beginnings of modern mathematics and, in consequence, the formation of a new rationality which began with the Islamic mathematicians. Then, the final sentence, if we write the history of mathematics and if we ignore what was the contribution, the real contribution, not to exaggerate this contribution, not to simplify this contribution, not to say that this mathematician invented everything. That is false. It is not true. But if we want to understand what their contribution to the beginning of modern mathematics in the 17th century, we cannot avoid to come back to them to understand this contribution from one side, and from other side, we cannot even understand what the Greek mathematician, the contribution of the Greek mathematicians, without looking for what they have been, how they have been understood from the 9th century on. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Rashed. Our next eminent speaker is Professor Emeritus Djebbar from the Liu University of Science and Technology. He's going to speak to us on discoveries in the Islamic world. I understand that he's going to speak in French, so, but there is translation, fortunately.
السلام عليكم استسمحكم على متابعتي المحاضرة باللغة الفرنسية لسببين السبب الأول هو أنني أدرس كل المصطلحات باللغة الفرنسية منذ 30 سنة والسبب الثاني هو أن هناك مترجمون فلابد أن يعملوا شيء من الفرنسية إلى العربية والإنجليزية. Je vais essayer de vous présenter rapidement un projet collectif réalisé en partie en France, en partie en Malaisie, et qui, j'espère, sera prolongé dans un des pays arabes et musulmans dans le futur proche. Il s'agit de l'utilisation des découvertes scientifiques des pays d'islam ou de certaines découvertes pour améliorer la pédagogie de l'enseignement des sciences, pour enrichir cet enseignement sur le plan culturel et pour développer à travers une meilleure connaissance de l'histoire des activités scientifiques des différentes civilisations, développer une compréhension entre les citoyens des différents espaces culturels d'aujourd'hui. Alors, je vais commencer par le fait que, dès la fin du 8e siècle et jusqu'au 16e, 17e siècle, en particulier pour l'astronomie, il y a eu différentes occasions en pays d'islam pour développer de nouvelles disciplines ou de nouveaux chapitres. En algèbre, en trigonométrie, en analyse combinatoire, en nombre harmonieux, c'était leur nom, carré magique, et en sciences du temps, et d'autres domaines encore. À droite, c'est la première page du livre d'algèbre d'Al-Khawarizmi. Il y a eu aussi des innovations technologiques nombreuses. Les valves coniques, le vilebrequin, l'arbre à cames, le piston, et d'autres innovations, celles-ci en partie, en grande partie, sont l'œuvre d'un ingénieur mécanicien syrien, Al-Jazari. Mais il y a eu des apports depuis le 9e siècle jusqu'au 16e siècle dans le monde ottoman. Il y a eu aussi des innovations en statique. L'image que vous voyez et la balance de la sagesse. Il y a eu aussi des innovations moins connues dans ce qu'on appelle les instruments graphiques, c'est-à-dire l'utilisation du graphique pour résoudre automatiquement et rapidement, par une bonne approximation, certains problèmes mathématiques ou astronomiques. Je donne deux exemples. Le quadrant sinus et les cartes mathématiques d'origine dont les modèles safavides nous sont parvenus, mais qui sont d'origine beaucoup plus ancienne. Il y a aussi les clepsydres, les horloges à eau. Il y a eu beaucoup d'innovations dans ce domaine. Je vous donne juste quelques noms du Xe siècle au XIIe siècle. Ibn Yunus en Égypte, Al-Moradi en Andalus, qui a remplacé l'eau par le mercure. Al-Zarqali, qui a réalisé de grandes horloges, comme en Syrie d'ailleurs, au XIIe, XIIIe siècle. Al-Khazini, etc., etc. La page de droite est une page d'Al-Moradi d'Al-Andalus. Il y a aussi l'astrolabe universel, qui est un prolongement et un enrichissement de l'astrolabe planisphérique d'origine grecque. Et l'un des premiers est Al-Zarqali, il y a aussi évidemment Ibn Khalaf d'Al-Andalus, qui est à l'origine de ce développement. Il y a des innovations en optique, dont certaines ont été révélées ces dernières décennies, comme celle d'Ibn Sehl, d'Ibn al-Haytham, d'Al-Farisi. Et puis il y a d'autres contributions nombreuses, je ne peux pas les citer toutes, c'est juste pour vous expliquer qu'il y a une matière très très riche dont nous connaissons le contenu, parfois dans le détail, et qui est une matière première pour un meilleur enseignement des sciences. Il y a par exemple la méthode expérimentale, il y a la circulation, la petite circulation du sang, il y a l'extension de la notion de nombre. Vous voyez, je passe des aspects pratiques aux aspects théoriques. Il y a des nouvelles idées autour d'outils mathématiques. Il y a l'introduction du concept de mouvement en géométrie, etc., etc. Alors, cette histoire des sciences, qui concerne le monde musulman, à côté d'autres, évidemment, contributions d'autres civilisations, babyloniennes, grecques, chinoises, indiennes, égyptiennes et européennes, peuvent être mises au service d'un meilleur enseignement des sciences, dans tous les pays, et en particulier dans les pays arabes et musulmans. Alors, il y a eu quelques expériences qui ont été initié dans ce sens-là. Il y a eu d'abord à l'UNESCO en 2005-2006, à l'occasion de l'exposition L'âge d'or des sciences arabes, dont j'ai été le commissaire et qui a été présentée à l'Institut du monde arabe à Paris, il y a eu une initiative de l'UNESCO chapeautée, dirigée par notre collègue Mustafa Al-Tayeb et qui a abouti parallèlement à l'exposition à l'organisation d'un colloque à l'UNESCO sur comment introduire ou développer l'introduction de l'histoire des sciences dans les universités arabes et musulmanes. Des chercheurs et des enseignants et des responsables d'institutions sont venus de différents pays arabes et musulmans et il y a eu des recommandations très très importantes qui ont été faites et qui ont été approuvé par les personnes présentes. Alors il serait intéressant, dans le cadre qui est ici, de pouvoir éventuellement revenir à cette initiative et de discuter des résultats de ces recommandations et de leur mise en pratique. En tout cas, ces recommandations concernaient le développement, l'amélioration de l'enseignement des sciences à l'université, et l'introduction d'une dimension culturelle par la culture scientifique à l'université. Il y a eu aussi, à peu près à la même époque, en Europe, comme vous le savez, l'introduction de la nouvelle réforme dans l'enseignement supérieur. Licence, master, doctorat. Peut-être que beaucoup de collègues aujourd'hui ne le savent pas, mais cette nouvelle initiative européenne de Bologne a créé la possibilité d'introduire d'une manière officielle l'enseignement de l'histoire des sciences en licence. Dans certains pays, cet enseignement est obligatoire, Dans d'autres pays, il est, disons, optionnel jusqu'au moment où on formerait des cadres. Et dans les pays du Maghreb, qui, comme vous le savez, ont adopté le LMD, et dans les pays de l'Afrique subsaharienne, du Sénégal jusqu'au Togo, Niger, etc., qui ont adopté ce LMD, il y a aussi un début d'introduction de l'enseignement de l'histoire des sciences pour améliorer la pédagogie de l'enseignement des sciences et pour introduire la dimension culturelle. Et puis, tout cela, évidemment, concerne l'université. Et puis, un jour, des collègues ont eu l'idée d'introduire cette démarche, non pas à l'université, mais dans l'enseignement primaire, les deux dernières années du primaire et les deux premières années du collège. C'était une innovation très, très importante. Et donc, cette innovation, elle a commencé, en fait, aux États-Unis et poursuivie d'une manière puissante en France, et elle a été appelée la main à la pâte. Elle a été initiée par des physiciens. Alors, cette démarche consiste à apprendre à l'enfant, pas à l'étudiant, à l'enfant, à lui apprendre à découvrir des choses, d'abord à observer, à poser des questions, à faire des petites expériences, à essayer de dégager des idées nouvelles, et aussi, c'est lié, à maîtriser la langue de l'enseignement scientifique et à maîtriser la langue de communication. On lui apprend aussi par cette méthode, en plus du développement de la curiosité, d'avoir le courage d'innover, d'avoir le courage d'avoir des idées nouvelles, d'avoir des idées techniques nouvelles et de produire quelque chose de nouveau. Et puis surtout, cette méthode, dès l'âge de 9 ans, 10 ans, permettrait d'apprendre à penser avec un esprit critique. Vous voyez, le programme est très très large et très ambitieux. Mais ce programme n'est pas si ambitieux que cela, puisqu'il a été testé, il a été expérimenté et il a donné des résultats. Alors, il a été testé d'abord aux États-Unis par le professeur Léon Lederman, qui était le propre professeur du second initiateur, qui est le professeur Jean.